things seem just out of your reach. Faces and places seem strange and they unsteady your feet. You lay your head down thinking nobody cares.
Everybody, this is Richard Sachs. I'm your host on Lost Arts Radio. This is our show for worldwide broadcast on the 20th day of May, 2018. And I want to tell you how we got to the topic for today's show. It's going to be great, and I hope you will let anybody else you know that's interested in this topic be aware of it, because this is an important series we're starting. You know that we share a lot of guests and topics with Alex Jones, whom I recommend for news. And recently he's really gotten into the 5G topic. He seems to have clicked into the threat from it, and it is throwing attention into it fully, which is great. And so I thought, well, and I've talked to some of his other guests that are close to him too about finding the best people that we could to lay the groundwork for the understanding of the public that's not totally familiar with this issue yet. And I thought there should be two parts of that. One is, what is it? Okay, this is not just for people already familiar with the subject, but we want to bring in everybody else who may never have even heard of it before. So what is it? What's the whole microwave issue about? What's 5G as the latest installment of that? What, if anything, does it do in relation to human health or the health of other organisms in the biosphere, the environment in general? And then if we find out that there's anything wrong with it and a reason not to have it, is there a way to stop it? And we'll get into that next. So today's topic is, what is it? What effect does it have on living organisms? And we're super fortunate to have, well, I think, the best person qualified to deal with this part of it, Dr. Martin Pall. And I want to give you something on his background, so, because we're going to be talking about scientific subjects here, and I think it's relevant to actually tell you a little bit about his bio in some detail, not long, but very precise. So I want you to know he got a BA degree in physics from Johns Hopkins, Phi Beta Kappa with honors. That was in the 60s, and graduated from there, and then got a PhD in biochemistry and genetics from Caltech in 68, and he's an assistant professor of Reed College, I think that's in Oregon, from 67 to 72, assistant associate and full professor of genetics and cell biology and biochemistry, biophysics, and later professor of biochemistry and basic medical sciences, Washington State University, 72 to 2008, professor emeritus of biochemistry and basic medical sciences, Washington State University. He's gotten 9 international honors for research in environmental medicine, author of 103 professional publications, one of which I was just fortunate to read, and it was great and gives me some background more for this discussion. Research since 1998 focused on mechanisms of chronic disease, oxidative nitrosative stress, inflammation, mitochondrial dysfunction, other mechanisms, environmental stressors causing chronic disease, regulatory systems acting to prevent chronic disease, chemicals acting to trigger chronic disease via excessive NMDA activity, mechanism of activity of electromagnetic fields via activation of voltage-gated calcium channels, which are going to be a key element in this discussion here. But we're not going to make it too technical. I want to bring it down to not miss the technical parts, but translate those so that everybody follows what we're saying. And it should be a super interesting and very important discussion. So welcome, Dr. Pall, and thanks for the time. I really appreciate it.
Pleasure to be here.
I thought, since our time's going to go by really fast, if it's past experience is any indication, then I'd like to start by introducing people to you, not just as a name and some professor talking, but as a person even before you got interested in the subject. Say where it came from, how you came to this field, and what you've been doing in it briefly up to now, not to take all of our time, but just for context, and then we'll get into what you're doing now and why this topic that we're going to talk about is important.
Okay. So I got started in environmental medicine around the year 2000. Okay. And most of the work that I published during the subsequent years was on how chemicals work to cause various kinds of diseases. But I was always interested in the electromagnetic fields, the EMFs, because we have a phenomenon with chemicals called multiple chemical sensitivity, where people become highly sensitive to chemicals. And then we also have a similar type of condition called electromagnetic hypersensitivity, sometimes abbreviated EHS, mm-hmm. where people are highly sensitive to electromagnetic fields. And so, you know, having worked on the chemicals and how they work, I was always interested in how the EMFs can work. And so I found what appears to be the main mechanism back in late 2012 and published the first paper in 2013 on it. And that was, I think, a very big breakthrough. And the reason for that is that, you know, in biology, so complex, when you don't know what the direct targets are of these things, you really don't understand things, and things are very muddy. Right. When you do know what it is, then things are vastly clearer, so it makes a huge difference.
All right, so just out of curiosity, you say you were always interested in the EMF aspect. What first brought that to your attention when you were involved before that just with the chemicals?
Well, I mean, the fact that you do get sensitivity to both of them, and in fact, both the chemicals and the EMFs, and the chemicals work, I don't want to wipe everybody out, but the chemicals work by activating something called NMDA receptors. And I thought, well, the EMFs are probably working the same way, but I never could find any evidence that that was true. Mm-hmm. Until I found, actually, the EMFs work on something that produces very similar responses in the cells of our bodies, but by a different mechanism. And so that immediately said, okay, we're on to something that's very important.
Okay. I guess one detail that I wanted to pick up in there is that, you know, you see people walking around with their cell phones right on their heads all the time, and women are putting them in their bras and men in their pants and thinking that it doesn't even occur to them that there's a problem. So I think that even with increased awareness, the vast majority of the population still trusts that everything government approves is safe. What made you question that, you know, which is really different than the way most people think?
Well, I think basically because I've seen so many things where government organizations and also industry organizations have said things were perfectly safe when we knew absolutely from the science that they weren't safe. And so, and in fact, you know, there was a huge amount of evidence that the EMFs, the electromagnetic fields, are not safe. And that the main claim of industry, which has been supported by a number of government agencies, that they're only what are called thermal effects, that is heating effects, is completely wrong. That you do get many, many impacts on the body at levels that produce essentially no heating in the body and therefore are not caused by heating.
Right. But that was actually a very... I guess they figured it was a very brilliant strategy, because if you could reduce the question to does it make you too hot or not, or something that comes from the heating effect, and just show that, well, no, you don't get really hot by having the cell phone on your head, then the question's all over, right? It makes it really simple.
That's right, but it's also completely wrong.
Right, except for that.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So what did you do to start investigating if there was something going on with those things?
What I found, and let me just say, all of this information that I'll be talking about is not based on experiments that I've done or epidemiological studies that I've done. These are all based on other people's work that's been published in the scientific literature. So what I found initially was that there were two studies that showed that there were effects that are produced that could be blocked by certain drugs called calcium channel blockers. And those drugs are highly specific for blocking what are called voltage-gated calcium channels. In other words, they're specific channels in the outer membrane of cells, the plasma membrane that surrounds all our cells, that can open up and allow calcium to flow into the cell, and they do that in response to electrical changes. So here we have the electromagnetic fields activating those same channels, and that was first shown in two studies, and then I kept looking for more and more, and I eventually found 23 and 24 and 26. Now I've got, I don't know, another dozen or so that I haven't published on. But so there are a lot of different studies that show that that's the target of various kinds of electromagnetic fields, various kinds of EMFs. The ones we're most concerned about are the microwave frequency ones, because those are the ones where our exposures are just skyrocketing, and so those are the main concerns. But the other EMFs are also of concern.
Okay, so just to make sure what you said so far is clear to everybody, but you know, the people that understand something about calcium in relation to our body have probably heard things like, "Well, you need calcium in your bones," and they're thinking that it's kind of this inanimate little piece of rock that goes in there and makes your bones strong. But what you're implying is that calcium does a lot more than that, and it's carrying maybe information or messages across the membrane, which is that little kind of fabric around every one of the 50 to 100 trillion cells in your body, and that defines the cell by being its border. And the calcium's going, I guess, two ways, back and forth, right? To trigger certain reactions that the cell needs to know when to do them. Is that accurate?
Yes. You see, in normal circumstances, in most cells in the body, the calcium levels in the cell are about 1/10,000th the calcium levels outside the cell. So there's much more calcium outside than inside, and the only time when the calcium levels go up in the cell is when the cell needs to use it for some regulatory response. So it, you know, it lets calcium in, and then it produces a regulatory change in the cell, and then it pumps it out.
Okay.
So it's very, very important for our cells to keep calcium levels normally in the cell very, very low. And because of that, when you activate these channels and you allow lots and lots of calcium ions to flow into the cell, they cause all kinds of problems, and we'll talk about what some of them are. Okay. So by activating these channels, the EMFs are doing really horrendous things to us.
Okay, and cells are really small. So in order for calcium to get into the cell, we must be talking about some kind of single molecule with calcium in it, what form does it go in?
It goes in as an ion, as calcium ions have two positive charges on them.
Okay.
And so it's just a calcium ion, just a single atom of calcium with two positive charges on it that goes into the cell. And when these channels are opened, they allow about 1 million calcium ions to flow in to the cell per second. So you can get a huge flux of calcium into the cell.
1 million into a single cell is what you're saying.
1 million ions through a single channel. There could be many channels in the,
In
the cell. So you can get a lot of calcium going into that cell very quickly if you're activating these channels when you shouldn't be.
And then do we know what normally activates the channels and makes that happen?
Yes, it's a change in the charge across the plasma membrane, the electrical charge across the plasma membrane.
So it's being pulled by a negative charge inside the cell or something like that?
So these channels are you know, complex proteins that are sitting in the membrane.
Okay.
And they have in that protein structure something called the voltage sensor. And that voltage sensor detects the electrical charge across the membrane. Mm-hmm. And when it actually decreases, when the charge decreases, it opens the channel, and you get you get calcium ions flowing in. So that's the normal physiology.
Okay.
What's happening in the abnormal situation where the EMFs activated is that the EMFs are interacting with the same voltage sensor, and they're telling it to open, and it does, and then you get huge amounts of calcium flowing into the cell.
It's like hacking an electronic lock and fooling it, or something, right?
That's a good analogy. Yeah, that's interesting. Mm-hmm.
Does calcium sometimes have to go out as well, and is that a different mechanism or the same thing?
No, it's a different mechanism, and it takes a lot of energy to pump it out. There are calcium pumps in the membrane that pump it out. As I say, the body uses, you know, is very careful about not letting too much calcium in, and what the EMFs are doing is going around the body's protection, and that's why, or at least that's part of the reason why this is such a serious problem.
Okay.
So what we're talking about here is you know, we're talking about the industry claiming that they're only heating effects, and that's the only thing you have to worry about.
Mm-hmm.
And it's completely wrong. What it's doing is activating these channels and allowing way too much calcium into the cell. So it's the calcium in the cell that's the important thing here.
Sounds super dangerous to me.
It is.
It's kind of amazing that flooding the cell with calcium, that you would survive that, actually. I guess it fortunately only happens up to a certain point, or you wouldn't, right?
Well, I think our survival is at risk, is at great risk, but it's not something that it's not something that sort of hits you right away. It's the longer term effects that seem to be the most serious ones.
Right. So your research has been looking for what was really already known but not widely realized, and then analyzing that and presenting it so people would be aware of it.
There were studies going back to the 1950s and even to the 1930s showing that these the microwave frequency EMFs have non-thermal health impacts and of various sorts, and a lot of these early studies showed already what the most sensitive organs were in the body and how they respond to these EMFs. And interestingly, the U.S. government put out reports, one of them published in 1971, another one in 1981, another one in, I think the last one was in 1986, acknowledging that there were multiple non-thermal effects. And many other organizations also acknowledged that there were non-thermal effects. And then all of a sudden, people are forgetting about it.
Wow, how interesting.
Yeah.
So when they had to put together the strategy for the proliferation of this massive network of cell phones and wireless communication of various kinds, they must have had to deal with the fact that this information existed at some point in their strategy, right?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. There was a lot of propaganda put out to the contrary. It's really bizarre how all this could possibly have occurred. So we're not just talking about cell phones. We're talking about all kinds of electromagnetic fields. Some of these were, you know, occupational exposures that were studied back in the late 1970s, and when there was almost nothing else that was producing these exposures, including radar, for example.
Oh, okay.
But there were others also that, you know, where people reacted to the EMFs with various kinds of health impacts that were documented. What was the other thing that came into this that I think was extremely chilling was that starting in 1986, the U.S. government started shutting down their research in this area.
Wow, that's interesting.
So in 1986, the Environmental Protection Agency had a in-house research arm studying these things. They shut that down. The U.S. Office of Naval Medical Research, Naval Research, was funding grants in this area, and they shut that down. Later on, the NIEHS, which is the environmental health part of NIH, shut down their research in this area. And then the last thing that got shut down was in 1999, was the Department of Energy had some studies on this that they were funding, and they shut that down. So everything was shut down.
And so that's either total what would you call it? Meaningless coincidence, or there's some kind of collusion that we may not be fully seeing.
Well, yeah. I think that, the consequence of those is that, you know, we take great pride in the science in the U.S. You know, we have more Nobel laureates than any other country by far. And we say, oh, U.S. is the number one science country. In this area, we're almost nowhere to be found. And so the consequence of that, because of this shutdown of the funding, is that of the 17 studies that have been published on people living near cell phone towers, not a single one was done in the U.S.
Hmm.
Of the 23 studies on genuine Wi-Fi effects, not a single one was done in the U.S. Of the over 50 studies done on genuine cell phone radiation, there's only one that was done, and that's the recent NTP study that was demanded by the Congress. So we're basically nowhere. I have to say the UK, which is usually considered the number two science country, is also nowhere in this area. So it's really bizarre, and you have other countries that have fortunately have picked up at least some of the slack here, and we're grateful to them for doing so. But we have nothing to be proud of in this whole thing, and I say that with great regret as a U.S. scientist.
All right. What makes sense in kind of structuring this part of the discussion? Should we go in a timeline through the way that your research progressed and what you found out by stages? What do you think?
I think maybe what we should do is talk about some of the things that we know the EMFs do.
Okay.
And then I can tell you a little bit about how these effects are produced.
Yeah, great.
Would that be okay?
Yeah, that'd be great. Let's do that.
So, I one of the things that I've done recently is collect a lot of different review articles. So these are articles where people have reviewed particular parts of this of this story, and you know, and of course, in order to get those reviews published, you have to have a lot of different studies that you can cite showing various things. And so there are large numbers of reviews that show that there are various kinds of non-thermal effects, that is, effects that are not due to heating. And those include a wide variety of effects on the nervous system, including the brain. And those include both neurological and neuropsychiatric effects. And in humans, the neuropsychiatric effects involve many of the things that almost everybody seems to be complaining about nowadays. I can't sleep, I'm tired all the time, I can't concentrate, my memory doesn't work, I'm depressed, I'm anxious, etc. I mean, all those things that everybody complains about, or almost everybody seems to complain about, we know are caused by EMF exposure. And there are five different reviews that have each shown a very similar pattern of these neuropsychiatric effects being caused by the EMFs. And there are different kinds of EMFs. I mean, some of these were the things that people were exposed to 30, 40 years ago. Some of them are things that, you know, that are new, you know, that like people who use their cell phones heavily, people who live near cell phone towers, people who are in Wi-Fi fields, etc. People who are impacted by smart meters, and you know, and then radar is another important cause of this. And so all these things come into it, and they all have fairly similar effects. There are also effects, and I'll talk about how these fit in. But you get oxidative stress, which is involved in almost every single chronic disease you can name, and you get excessive calcium in the cell and excessive calcium signaling, not surprisingly from what we've already said. You get, in addition, you get reproductive effects. And these have been studied in both in animals and in humans. And the reproductive effects involve effects on male fertility, where you get major changes in the structure of the testis, where you get lowered sperm count and lowered sperm quality. And those two, of course, are always important, because those are standard. You know, if you have a couple that goes in and is having trouble conceiving, mm-hmm. you know, the first thing you look is, you know, does the man have normal sperm count? Is the sperm of normal quality? Well, so these are big issues. There's also effects on female fertility, and there are also changes in the structure of the ovary and loss of the oocytes in what are called vesicles. And so those things go on. You also get decreases in each of the three types of sex hormones. Estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, all three of them go down.
Wow.
And you get lowered libido. So we're being affected by almost anything you can name in terms of reproduction. There are also effects on the DNA of cells, including the DNA of sperm cells. So what can that do? Well, it can cause mutations. And it can also cause cancer. And so those are all of great concern. And there are 35 different reviews that I found that show that EMFs cause cancer. So there should be no question about that. But, of course, the industry says, nah, it can't possibly be true.
Right, exactly. We would have told you if it was, right?
Yeah, well, no, they don't say that. What they say is that the government says it's not a problem. And some mm-hmm. of the government agencies do say that, which is one of the worst things. We're in very, very deep trouble. Okay, what else is going on? There are also hormonal effects. Every single hormone system in the body, as best I can determine, is impacted by the EMFs. There are cardiac effects, which are life-threatening, that involve the control, the electrical control of the heart. So the electrical control of the heart is impacted by the EMFs. And, you know, you may not know this, but the heart has a biological pacemaker that regulates the beating of the heart. And so, and the cells in that pacemaker are called pacemaker cells, not surprisingly. Yeah. And they're controlled by these voltage-gated calcium channels. So,
and they're controlled by what? I couldn't quite hear that part.
The pacemaker cells are controlled by these voltage-gated calcium channels.
Okay.
So that, I believe, it's a direct effect on those cells, that the EMFs produce a direct effect on those cells. And they produce various kinds of effects on the heartbeat depending on the circumstance. So you can get tachycardia, very rapid heartbeat. You can, over time, with extensive exposures, also get bradycardia, slow heartbeat. You get arrhythmias, and arrhythmias, as some of you may know, are associated with sudden cardiac death. We have an epidemic of young, apparently healthy athletes dying in the middle of an athletic competition of sudden cardiac death, and that's unexplained. I think there is an explanation. I think the explanation involves EMFs, but, you know, one can question that. There's one other thing which occurs, and that's heart palpitations also occur. And anyway, we can talk about how all these things can occur, but basically I think they all occur through the impact of the EMFs on these VGCCs, the voltage-gated calcium channels, in the pacemaker cells in the heart. So those are some of the things that we worry about, but there are others. I mean, this thing goes on and on. And there is reason to think that we have a problem with very early onset Alzheimer's and other dementias. And there are a few, you know, cases now of Alzheimer's showing up where people age 30 are coming down with Alzheimer's, something that's totally unheard of in previous years.
Yeah.
And there's some animal studies which argue that the EMFs can cause Alzheimer's, and there's also information from the basic mechanism of Alzheimer's that supports the view that the EMFs can cause it. So that's a plausible mechanism, and there have been some rat studies that show basically that by giving young rats a series of pulsed short pulses of microwave frequency, you can induce an Alzheimer's-like dementia in the rat as a middle-aged rat. So, you know, you expose them for a while as a young rat, then you stop exposing them, and you look later, and what do you find? The rat's in trouble, in much the same way that many of us are. So, So those are things that are worrisome, and I think that there is reason to think that both ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and autism, which have a lot of similarities to each other, can be caused by the EMFs. And I'm not saying that the EMFs are the sole cause of either one of those. I do believe the chemicals have roles as well, but it's my opinion that the primary driver of the epidemics of both of them, and we have a huge epidemic of both of them, and is probably the EMFs rather than the chemicals.
Speaking of epidemics, what about the epidemic of childhood cancer?
That's a big problem. Yeah, there is. Okay, so There are studies that have shown that that people who are exposed to to high levels of EMFs have higher cancer, and that it seems to affect children more than adults in terms of the percent increases. And so, for example, there are large increases in people living near cell phone towers, and unfortunately, something like 30% of us live within 300 meters, or about 1,000 feet of a cell phone tower, and in those distances, people are impacted by the EMFs from the cell phone tower. So, and that's just one of, but you look at what else is going on, and you find that, when basically all the things that I mentioned to you, where they've been looked at for people living near cell phone towers have been shown to be elevated. A couple of them have never been looked at. I think the reproductive effects are one of those. And nobody's looked at ADHD and autism either from people living near cell phone towers. So there are huge, huge numbers of things where, we are just not looking at the obvious questions. And they are obvious. So we are in extraordinarily deep trouble. Can I say something about the reproduction?
Yeah, we have time. Let's go into whatever you feel is important. This is a class, basically, for everybody to come back to.
Okay. So we talked about the fact that we know that these reproductive things are affected, and there are in both animals and in humans. And so then the question is, do we see any evidence for this out in the wider populations? And the answer is yes. We do see effects in every single technologically advanced country on Earth. Sperm counts have dropped by over 50% from what we used to consider normal. I mean, that's absolutely stunning. Now, it's conceivable that something else is causing it, but we don't know what it could be. Whereas we do know the EMFs do this, and we do know that the EMFs are present in all of these countries at high levels. Mm-hmm. So, so that's the obvious cause. Yeah. Is there, in fact, an effect on reproduction here? The finding is, and these are World Bank figures, well, the World Bank has data on reproduction in, I think, almost every country in the world. And what they show, this is based on 2015 or 2016 data, is that every single technologically advanced country on Earth, with a single exception, reproduction has dropped below replacement levels.
Wow.
And that means that basically we're looking at not immediate declines in population, but we're looking at immediate declines in the numbers of babies born, and subsequently, of course, if this continues, and I think it's going to get much worse, in fact, we're going to have a big drop in young school children and then workers and so forth. So they're big issues there. And nobody's worrying about this stuff. It's just bizarre beyond belief.
Yeah.
So, this is something that is, I think, very worrisome. And let me just say one other thing about this. That's one of my big worries, and it's one that, unlike these areas where we've got good data, is where we really don't have good data, and that has to do with mutations.
Hmm. Okay.
one of the things about, so it's been known going all the way back to the 1950s that these EMFs produce chromosomal rearrangements. As you break, when you break your chromosomes, which you can do with ionizing radiation, and this shows you can do with these microwave frequency and lower frequency EMFs. What happens is that when you get double-strand breaks, the chromosomes tend to stick back together, but they don't stick back together the right way often. You get different structures. And when you do that, if the breaks themselves are not that important, it may not show up as anything, you know, that big a deal. But in the next generation, when those individuals try to reproduce, and they've got different chromosome structure from their mate, because either or both of them have had these kinds of rearrangements, then you have high levels of sterility.
That's kind of like two species that don't match, right?
Exactly. Yeah, very much like two species that don't match. And so there may be, you know, so we not only have the issue of immediate sterility, that we're already getting close to. But in addition, we've got another issue, and that is that that we may already have a lot of chromosomal rearrangements, which will cause sterility, much more severe sterility, even if we stop exposures today completely. Yeah. There may already be a lot of genetic damage that's going to cause a lot of sterility in the next generation. So we may well have a absolute crash in all of our technologically advanced countries because of the deterioration of our brain function, and because of the deterioration of our reproductive function, and because of the attacks on the DNA of our cells.
You mentioned radar as one of the sources. What about these giant facilities, you know, in the Northwest, but all over the place, all over the whole country, really, called NEXRAD, that are putting out these gigantic fields? Do you know much about those?
I don't know.
They're definitely controlling weather patterns, but they're doing it by means of this giant radar system that is coordinated all over the country. It's been correlated with patterns in storms and things, but they must be putting out very powerful EMF, I would think.
Yeah, I don't know anything about it, so I can't comment on it.
Okay, just one more radar example.
Yeah. I've been told that a lot of the research in some of these areas have been classified, so you know, so we don't have access to them. But you know, there certainly is some evidence that radar is problematic. For example, and that it causes cancer, among other things. Mm-hmm. But one of the studies that suggests that EMFs can cause autism was a study that was done in a town on the New Jersey coast where there's a big radar station, where it was found that the autism rates were quite high there. Uh-huh. They weren't sort of super high to the point where you say, okay, this is a huge red flag, but they were quite high, and that was, you know, that was of concern there. And I don't think any of those have been repeated since then. And we just had one study that was published, and that was it. So, yeah.
You had a lot of interesting observations in the paper that you gave me to read on how these agencies are working to try to discredit any of these obvious findings you're talking about, right? You want to say how that works a little bit?
You know, what I gave you had two different things, and one of them had to do with a organization that goes by the acronym Center, SCENIHR, and I can't remember exactly what that stands for. It doesn't make terribly much difference. This is a European organization that came out with the most extensive document that claims that nothing is established in terms of, you know, our understanding of EMFs causing anything. And that document had 47.5 pages of citations in it. So, you know, you have a lot of citations. You say, well, okay, they must be looking at everything, mm-hmm. right? But when you look at it more carefully, what you find is that there are huge literatures that are left out, including these reviews that I talked about that fell into the time frame of the center document. Of those reviews, there were 22 there were 77 reviews that I had on these various topics. Of those, if I remember correctly, there were 22 that fell into the time frame that was supposed to be covered by Center. They only looked at two of those, and one of them was actually my 2013 paper. But when they looked at two of those, they left out essentially everything in my paper and all except one important thing in the other paper that they discussed, and then they just dropped it. So neither one of those things had any influence on any final conclusions that they were making. So you have this entire review literature, basically, that is left out. And then pretty much the same thing was true with the genuine cell phone studies. Most of them were left out, and the ones that were put in there were, you know, they basically left out much of the important things that were found in those papers. So they didn't have any influence either. So and then there are a whole series of things where they simply had false statements, and that I documented as well. And so this is all, you know, it's all crazy. The other thing I'd say about this, and it's something that's important, it's something that we haven't talked about, and that is that there are a number of factors that influence how potent these EMFs are in producing effects. Okay. And the one that was most extensively documented is that EMFs that are highly pulsed, that pulse up and down very rapidly, are in most cases much more biologically active than the non-pulsed EMFs. And every single wireless communication device communicates via pulsations. So they are in principle, and I believe in practice, much more dangerous as a consequence of that.
Okay.
And so what you often have is, that's not the only factor that's important, but it's the one that's best documented. There are also effects of the polarization of these EMFs and some other things, which I guess I won't mention at this point. But the point is that it's not hard. Oh, another thing which is important is the kind of cell you're studying. So you can look, for instance, at DNA damage in cells. And some cells are much more susceptible to having DNA damage than others. Now, it's perfectly possible then for the industry to have any number of studies that are done under conditions where you're not likely to see effects. And what that means is that when you count numbers of studies that didn't show any obvious effect, it doesn't make any difference how many there are. You know, this is what they do. This is what the center organization did, and that's what the industry does, and that's what the other organization, they count numbers.
Right. But you're saying the reason it doesn't make any difference is because you're not looking at the ones that did show an effect.
Exactly. You're looking under different conditions.
Okay.
And so when you're looking under different conditions, especially when you know those conditions, of course, the industry will say, well, we don't know about that. But so that's the kind of situation that we're in. We're in a situation where you can have you can have studies that show that you didn't see any effects. And one way of doing that, by the way, which is commonly used, is just look at tiny numbers.
Right. Well, it's interesting, too, that the industry is using this pulsed idea that you said makes it more dangerous as a way to explain that it's safer, because, after all, there's only energy being transmitted during the pulses. Most of the time, there isn't anything.
Yeah, well, that's one thing. But, you know, the other thing is that they claim when you look at a non-pulse field, or at least a less pulse field, that's a better way to do it because you know how intense it is. And that's true. You know how intense it is. But it's not like the actual EMFs that we're actually exposed to, which vary in intensity widely from one microsecond to another.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that's true with cell phone radiation. It's true with cell phone towers. It's true with Wi-Fi. It's true with smart meters we haven't
smart
even talked
meters,
about.
Right.
And,
right.
And so all of these, and even radar actually pulses in two different ways. We're in a situation where you know, we have a lot of complexity here. And basically, you know, it's being, so much of this is just being hidden from the public. And, we're in extraordinarily deep trouble.
You want to say a little bit about how smart meters fit into all that, since you mentioned them?
Well, smart meters, I'm not the world's greatest expert on smart meters, but, you know, they pulse, they give out short pulses. That, and in fact, short signaling periods, and within the signaling period, you have lots of pulsations. And so, you know, what smart meters do is they allow the electric companies, and there are also smart meters that can be used to measure gas and water. It allow the company to measure, you know, how much electricity you're using. The peculiar thing about this is that the smart meters pulse, put out these pulses many, many times a day, which they don't really need to. And so there are issues about privacy and what's being communicated here, but there's also issues, of course, about safety.
Right.
So basically, you know, what they are doing is they're giving out these pulses, and these pulses, at least they're superficially similar to the pulses I mentioned before that are causing Alzheimer's in rats.
Mm-hmm.
And so, right. Another thing which the industry often does is it talks about average exposures. And it says, well, you know, the exposure is such and such, and this is so low it can't produce any heating, so we don't need to worry about it. Well, of course, first of all, it's not heating that's going on here. And secondly, these short pulses can have major biological effects. In fact, there are a whole series of published studies that have shown that what are called nanosecond pulses, so these are pulses between 1 millionth and 1 billionth of a second in length, so they're very short things that go up and come back down. These have biological effects, and they also work via VGCC activation and through the same mechanism. And when you average these over even a second, you have essentially no intensity, right? Because
mm-hmm.
so short.
Yeah.
And typically what industry does is they average over minutes or hours.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, yeah, I've seen that. Looking at these averages has no connection with the actual biological effects, and it has nothing to do with with the actual effects.
It's like if somebody is stabbing you, you know, and they said, "Well, most of the time I didn't even stab you at all. It was only one time."
Right. Yeah. Right.
So on the average, shouldn't have had any effect.
The average pressure on your chest is so low.
Yeah, it was essentially nothing.
Anything.
You're just making it all up.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, it's similar. Yeah, it's a similar sort of thing. Right. Exactly. Yeah.
What about you? You want to get into the, you know, topic of 5G, because I mean that's what I think is getting a lot of new people interested in this stuff. Is there some big new program, and it's being sold in all the cities in America as a response to popular demand for more access, and they're constantly talking about this growing public hunger for more internet access, and this is going to finally make everything really great that way, and they call it 5G. And they don't mention the other aspect of it, which is the Internet of Things, and that's a whole other subject, I think, but it's important.
Yeah, I let me just say, okay, so let's talk about what 5G is.
Yeah.
So 5G, we talked about the importance of pulsations, and the pulsations that you get, that you can have, that is dependent on the frequency of the EMF that you're using. So you can't pulse faster than the frequency of EMFs, and so you're limited in your pulsations even in the microwave range. And so for instance, the EMFs that we're using with a lot of the cell phone radiation is about 2.45 gigahertz. And so what the industry is planning to do with 5G is to go up much, much higher in frequency, up to, and I'm not sure what the first ones are going to be. I think they're probably going to be on the order of 20 to 30 gigahertz. So roughly 10 times higher, but then they're planning to go up to 90 gigahertz and maybe even higher than that.
Okay,
so
without losing the train of thought, can you just tell people who may not know I know gigahertz is billions of cycles per second, right?
Right. One gigahertz is 1 billion cycles per second.
Okay, and what does that mean to somebody that doesn't really follow that?
It means that you have a wave. Okay, so let's take a simple thing that you're familiar with, 60 hertz. That's what our power frequency is supposed to be.
That's house current in the U.S., right?
Right. The house current in the U.S. is 50 hertz, so 60 hertz. So it goes up and down 60 times, basically. It has a wave that goes up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, 60 times a second. 1 gigahertz goes up and down 1 billion times per second. So that's obviously huge. But that's not big enough for the industry. They want to go much higher, okay? And the reason they want to go much higher is because you can carry much more information. The more you pulse, the more information you can carry per unit time.
Is the information a function of all the different relationships in the strength of the pulses or something like that? I know information, for example, in computers is a bunch of ones and zeros in all these different configurations.
Yeah.
But in an electric pulse, is it like the magnitude of the pulse? Or
yeah,
what?
Magnitude, you know, and when you look at these, they pulse up and down very, very rapidly. Well, obviously they do, to carry the information that's trying to be carried in this thing. So the idea of 5G is that, well, we're going to have this thing pulsing like mad. so that you can download your porn videos faster than you can do it now.
Right.
I mean, if I can use that term. And
or if you just need to download 10 videos within 5 minutes, you know, it's
well,
much
yeah.
better.
I mean, as if that were such a huge important thing.
Yeah.
The problem is, okay, so the first thing is that you can carry much more information, but you do it by pulsing much more, and when you know that the pulsations are important in terms of biological effects, that's problematic. The second thing is that these very high frequencies that they're planning to use are absorbed much more than the frequencies that we're currently using for, in the microwave range. And because of that, what they're planning to do is put out just gigantic numbers of antennae so that this will be able to penetrate anywhere you want, basically, in your house, in your office, wherever. So that's even though it gets absorbed rapidly. So that's problematic because, you know, you just got huge amounts of energy that's being put out. And then the question is, it will be all over the place, so it's impossible to avoid.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, so that's, now, I think that this absorption is itself problematic for another reason, and that is the way most of these things are absorbed is through their interaction with electrically charged groups, so chemical groups that have positive and negative charges on them. And the voltage sensor has electrically charged groups. So I predict that these very high, very high gigahertz frequencies that are going to be used will probably be particularly active in activating these VGCCs, which are the targets of the EMF.
So the voltage sensors that you're talking about are the ones that everybody has in every one of their cells.
In every one of these channels.
Yeah, lots of channels in every cell.
Each channel, right? Each channel has a voltage sensor in it. Each of these channels has a voltage sensor, and they're found in every single one of them. As far as I know, every single cell we have.
So those are the ones that could be the receptor centers for the EMF, basically.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. Okay. So now, I think they're going to be particularly active. Because of the interaction with the voltage sensors that control the VGCCs, but also because of the pulsations, which we know make them much more active. And so what does that tell you? What it tells you is we need to do biological testing where we can look at these EMFs, and we need to use genuine 5G radiation with all of the pulsations it will entail in order to test these things. The current plan that's already been approved by the Congress is to put out, and it's been pushed by the Federal Communications Commission, the FCC.
Yeah.
Is to put out tens of millions of these 5G antennae without doing one single biological safety test of genuine 5G. And that's already started in some cities around the country.
There must be great excitement within those companies about the money they can make from it.
This is stupid beyond belief. This is incredible that anybody would even think of doing that. It's just absolutely bizarre. And that's where we are. And I think, okay, so now let me just raise one other question, one other point about this, because it's one that it's a point that the industry has raised, and it's an important one. What the industry claims is that that because of the absorption of these EMFs as it hits our bodies, that 5G will only be active in the outer 1 to 2 millimeters of our bodies.
Yeah, which is what they say about the airport scanners, basically, too, right?
Yeah, that's not true either, right? Okay, yeah.
I mean, they're using something called millimeter waves, if I'm correct.
It's all, yeah, they're all millimeter waves, right? Yeah, the 5G and the airport scanners, is my understanding. Yeah. So they claim it'll only penetrate like 1 or 2 millimeters, so you don't need to worry about it. That's the basic argument that they use. Okay. Now, let me just say that with the microwave frequency EMFs, they also claim that it only works down through maybe 1 centimeter. And we know that's not true. We know that's not true because of the effects on the brain and on the heart and on, which are pretty deep in our bodies, and at least some of the hormonal effects are also deep in our bodies. So we know that's not true. And in fact, the most clear evidence on how deeply the microwave frequency EMFs work came from studies that were done by Professor Hessig and his colleagues in Switzerland. Okay, so Hessig is spelled H-A-S-S-I-G with an umlaut over the A. And he and his colleagues published two papers that showed that when pregnant cattle are grazing near a cell phone tower in Switzerland, they produce a lot of calves, newborn calves that have cataracts.
Wow.
So you're causing cataracts in utero, where the fetus is very deeply buried in the mother's body, and where the industry claim, oh, nothing can possibly happen because it's so deeply buried.
Mm-hmm.
Much, much deeper than is possible, according to the industry. And yet you get these cataracts, okay? And so the question is, how does that happen? And similar question is, how can 5G act deeply within our bodies? And so... So here we're going to talk about some physics. I hope I don't lose everybody here. It is the case that when you have an electromagnetic field, it has both electrical effects and magnetic effects.
Mm-hmm.
The electrical effects are rapidly attenuated in the body. That's true.
In other words, they don't penetrate very much, is what you're saying.
They don't penetrate very far. However, the magnetic parts of the EMFs are much, much more penetrating. Now, okay, so why is that important? And so let me just share with you. Let's go back to the voltage sensor. Okay, so the voltage sensor is detecting electrical effects. It's looking at electrical effects, and you say, well, so the electrical part is attenuated. So why do you care about the magnetic part? But the answer is, it is the case that magnetic fields can also activate these voltage-gated calcium channels.
Isn't that really because electricity and magnetism are two forms of the same thing that can go back and forth?
Well, I think yes and no. Yes, I think basically what's happening here is that the magnetic parts of the EMFs act in the biological fluids that we have. They push the charged groups, the ions that are dissolved in our biological fluids. They push them, you know, and or pull them, depending on which direction they're going. And so the magnetic part of the EMFs can essentially reconstitute the electrical parts with all of the pulsations and all of the with the exact frequency and all the pulsations, just at lower intensity in the body. Now, it turns out that the voltage sensor, this is something we haven't talked about, the voltage sensor is extraordinarily sensitive to very, very weak EMFs because of its structure. And this is all based on basic physics, okay? And I explain it if you want, but I'm not sure.
Well, you know, when most people think of magnetic fields, they think of something that only affects iron.
Yeah, no, the magnetic fields will affect any charged group when the magnetic fields are moving or when the charged group is moving. One of them has to move.
Okay.
And so you can get electrical effects as a consequence of that. And that's, in fact, how electrical generators work.
Yeah, I was just thinking that, right, in a car.
Yeah, yeah. So we have a situation here where basically where the physics predicts that you can regenerate these the electrical parts of the EMFs deeply within your body. And they then can activate the VGCCs. And I think that's what's happening with the cataract formation in these young calves, in the fetus of the calves. And I think that's happening with other situations. And I predict that that's exactly what's going to happen with 5G. Now, could I be wrong? Well, there's only one way to find out, and that's real biological testing of genuine 5G, which, of course, is exactly what is not being done. Mm-hmm. And so we're going ahead and doing these incredibly stupid things. And I think, we'll have pretty close to instant destruction if this goes ahead. And I'm certainly very concerned about that.
And it's starting now. I mean, Palo Alto and a few other places are already having it built.
I know, yeah. I was down in San Francisco last January, and they were already putting some up.
Yeah.
What I don't know, those things that they're putting up right now, they're supposed to be a combination of 4G and 5G. I don't know, and people are reacting to something. Mm-hmm. What I don't know is whether 5G is actually there, because I don't know that they've actually figured out what they're going to use with 5G. See, this is stupidity beyond belief, you know. I don't know that they know what they're actually going to use yet. So it may not be there, and people may be reacting to 4G. 4G may be problematic itself.
Right.
How is it possible that in this day and age, with all the science we know, that we can act in ways that are, as far as I can tell, stupider than anything that's ever occurred in history? I mean, I don't know. You know, I can't think of any examples that's stupider than this.
Yeah, even the people that think they're in control that are going to make the money or, you know, have this one, like the United Nations is interested in world population reduction. That it's not a great plan if it eliminates everybody completely.
Yeah. Should we talk more about the reproduction?
Sure.
One of the things I didn't get to with the reproduction has to do with the, what do we know from animal studies? And interestingly, the best animal study that was done on reproduction was published over 20 years ago now. There are many others that have been done, but the nice thing about this is it showed sort of time courses of effects. And so this was a study that was done with pairs of young mice, you know, one male, one female, that were put in little cages on the ground in an antenna park. So you have a whole bunch of broadcasting antennas, and what they were looking at then at was what happens to the mouse reproduction as a consequence of this exposure. And the exposures on the ground in this antenna park were well within our current safety guidelines. So if those safety guidelines had any biological relevance, nothing should happen. And what was found, and they put them, this was done in Greece by a couple of Greek researchers, Magras and Zinos. And they put these little mouse cages in two different locations in this antenna park, one with a somewhat higher level exposure, one with a somewhat lower level exposure. But as I've already said, these are all well within our safety guidelines.
All right.
So nothing should happen. Well, what happened was that immediately the other thing I want to mention is that mice have a gestation period of about 30 days.
Okay.
So they can produce a litter very quickly, and then go and produce another litter and so forth.
Right.
And so the first litter was the typical litter size was around 8.
Mm-hmm.
And the first litter was down with both exposures. Okay, so there was a statistically significant drop immediately in reproduction. And at the high level exposure, the higher level exposure, there was also a second litter produced, and then at the time of the third litter, it went down to essentially zero. So there was complete sterility.
Wow.
And in the lower level exposure, it was basically the same pattern, except that it took twice as long. So it was the fifth litter, they were completely sterile. There wasn't any reproduction, mm-hmm. or almost no reproduction. The other thing which is interesting is that the way they did these, the fifth litter actually was produced with no EMFs, no exposures. And so they took these mice, they put them elsewhere where there's no EMFs. They asked the question, do they recover? And the answer was, you see either no or almost no recovery.
Okay.
So the effects are irreversible, at least simply based on removing these exposures. So I mentioned before that we already have drops in sperm count by over 50%, and we're seeing reproductive rates that are well below replacement levels. So it's quite possible that we will have a crash in reproduction that's very similar to what you see with the mice. And let me just say, the only way in which you can get a drop in sperm count to below 50% without having, half of the people already completely sterile is to have almost everybody having effects. So almost every male in these technologically advanced societies is already impacted.
Right.
And, of course, there's no reason to think males are more sensitive than females in general, although there is one kind of effect in which they are more sensitive. We are more sensitive. So basically, if all the males are impacted, then there's no reason to think that all the females and all the children are not also impacted. There is reason to think that children are more sensitive than adults. And that fetuses may be still more sensitive. And that involves a number of factors, and one of them is that stem cells, which are the cells that, that differentiate into all the different cell types that we need,
yeah.
there are much more stem cells the younger you are. So there's much more stem cells in a fetus, and then as the child, as the, you know, after birth, it gets lower and lower with increasing age, and adults have the least number of stem cells.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one issue that I think is very important, that may cause the there to be much more effects in young people. There is also others, namely that the children have thinner skulls and they have smaller heads, and so they have more impact on the brains and so forth. There are other things that are going on as well, but there is and there is reason to think that there is particularly high sensitivity in the developing nervous system, particularly the developing brain. So those are things. And by the way, industry denies everything I have to say. I guarantee they will deny it.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to point that out, and I sort of take it as a badge of honor.
Right. Well, it's really interesting. You were in the beginning of the discussion, you were saying that you started with an interest in the chemical sensitivity and got into the electrical secondary.
Yeah.
And when you started talking about 3 to 5 generations of mm-hmm. mice mm-hmm. Were no longer able to reproduce after that number of generations,
mm-hmm.
that's almost exactly like the effect of genetically modified food, which is chemical. And they did a hamster study where after 3 generations, there weren't any more hamsters being born at all after they were being fed GMOs.
Oh, really? What kind of GMOs were they being fed?
I think it was corn and soy and stuff like that.
So this is probably, this could be a glyphosate effect, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly. It's hard to separate because they do use things like glyphosate all the time with it. And people who escape GMOs can still be eating glyphosate because they use it to dry wheat and stuff like that. But
yeah.
I just thought it was really interesting, you know, probably not a coincidence, that these really terrible technologies that are totally known to be suicidal to use are also both having the sterility effect.
Yeah, that's interesting. Okay, I didn't know about that. I didn't know about that effect. So let's talk about one other thing that I think is important. And here I have not, let me say, most of the things that I've talked about here I've published on. I haven't really published on the reproductive effects, although there are many publications on it. So
okay.
I want to talk about something else that I haven't published on, but that I think is important and particularly chilling. There are a number of research groups, I think 11 of them, that have suggested that the EMFs are likely to be important in causation of the autism epidemic.
Okay.
And there is a parallel between this huge increase in EMF exposures and the huge increase that we're seeing in autism. Now, that doesn't tell you that the one causes the other when you see a correlation of this sort, but it does mean that you need to look at it carefully. There's a similar correlation with ADHD. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, that it's gone up hugely in parallel with the increase in the EMFs. Now, so in both of these are thought to involve, impacts on the developing brain. And both of them have another important similarity, and that is they're much more common in males than in females.
That's interesting.
So autism is about 4.5, more times more common in male babies than in female babies. And ADHD, I think, is about 3.5 times more common in males than in females. So there are a lot of similarities here. And okay, so what is and so let me talk a little bit about ADHD, and that's that's discussed actually in that document that I sent you. Mm-hmm. So there was an interesting study was published, I'm trying to remember, 2012, I think, by Aldad et al. This was published from Hugh Taylor's lab at Yale, and where they showed I can't remember, I think they were doing this in rats. That microwave frequency EMFs cause large increases in ADHD in rats, and the exposures that were done in utero. So here you're looking at exposures before birth. So presumably during the time period when the brain is developing in the rat fetus.
Okay.
And so you get long-term behavioral effects in the rat. So the exposures are just in utero, but you see these effects after birth and even into adulthood in the rat. So there's a long-term change in the behavior of the rats because of the exposures in utero. Okay, and in both autism and in ADHD, I believe it's thought that there are also exposures after birth that can be important as well. So it's not just the in utero exposures, but it's the exposures during what's called the perinatal period, the period before birth and then relatively shortly after birth. Mm-hmm. So is the important thing. So now I'm trying to think now. So it turns out that there are also a couple of epidemiological studies that showed that there was a correlation between cell phone use of the mother and ADHD. Cell phone use, during pregnancy. And,
right. Yeah, tell people, too, what an epidemiological study is.
Epidemiological study is where you look at how various things influence how frequent particular disease responses are.
Okay.
And so you're trying to look, it's a correlative study. It doesn't directly show causation, but it can suggest causation if you have the right kind of patterns.
Okay.
That you're seeing. And so here what you're doing is you're looking at pregnant women who had different cell phone usage, and you're asking, does that influence the frequency of ADHD in the baby after it's after it develops? And these things, usually you have to wait several years before you actually see this, so it's not something that occurs immediately. But so these things are fairly difficult to study because you're looking at things that occurred, you have ADHD and not ADHD children, and now you're trying to backtrack into what was done before birth, and sometimes it's hard to remember exactly what was done. Mm-hmm. So, those are all things that, make it difficult. But this is just one kind of exposure. The study that was done in Hugh Taylor's lab at Yale was done with cell phone radiation in the rat. There have also been studies done in rats with other kinds of EMFs that have shown similar types of effects, including two studies on Wi-Fi radiation and one study on cordless phone radiation. And each of them was reported to have an increase in these neurological changes in the rat that are at least similar to what you see with ADHD in humans. So so these are very concerning. You know, is this proof that you know, the EMFs are the main cause of ADHD? I don't think it is proof, but it provides very substantial evidence that that's probably true, or at least that it has a significant causal role.
It also correlates with the movement into elementary schools and all the other schools of transmission devices right in the classroom.
Yes. And they have effects as well, but they may not. Yeah. So anyway, so those are big issues. Now what there are similar arguments with regard to autism, although autism is extraordinarily complex, and I'm not trying to oversimplify it. I believe that both EMFs and chemicals have roles in causing autism, and that they both act through excessive calcium in the cell. So when you have that kind of, you know, complexity, it makes it more difficult to assess the relative roles. But let me just say the following here. I believe that the primary mechanism here of both ADHD and autism has to do with the role of calcium in the developing brain. It turns out that there are four different mechanisms which help regulate the formation of what are called synapses in the developing brain. Okay, so the brain, of course, has, I don't know how many, huge numbers of neurons.
Mm-hmm.
And for those neurons to function, they have to form proper synaptic connections with other neurons, so they can either activate them or inhibit them.
And just so that we're clear for everybody, neurons are the individual cell units in a nerve, right?
And in the brain. And in this case, we're talking about in the brain. But So the neurons are the things that, you know, that the whole nervous system is dependent on the neurons to work. Right? They're the active parts of the nervous system. And so, you know, there, I don't know how many trillions of neurons we have, and, you know, huge numbers of neurons, and they have to form proper synaptic connections with other neurons. Now, it turns out there are four different mechanisms that are involved in the formation and regulating the formation of the synapses in the developing brain. Every single one of these is regulated by intracellular calcium. So if you've got too much calcium in the cell because of EGCC activation, it's going to impact these quite heavily. And I think that's exactly what's happening in both autism and in ADHD, that you're affecting these, So, is that proof that that's what's going on? No, it's not. But it's a very strong argument, and it really means that, you know, we are doing so many things so stunningly stupidly. It's just incredible.
What, you know, if... go ahead, I'm sorry.
The risks that we're taking are just, you know, are almost impossible to imagine, you know, and...
Well, it's almost inappropriate to call it risk, because risk implies only a possibility of damage, right?
Well, I think you know, I think with these, with autism and ADHD, you can argue that maybe this isn't going on. I'm not convinced by such arguments. But in fact, I'm sure that this is going on. And there is, you know, there is, when you've got these three different types of EMFs that I mentioned before, that in animals produce ADHD-like effects from, you know, the irradiation in utero, that's really quite strong evidence that this is going on. And there's other evidence as well, but this is, you know, and so but these are things that, you know, every single autism child impacts the entire family.
Mm-hmm.
And we're now up to, I think the last figure was one birth in 44?
38, I heard last. And
38? Okay.
Yeah. But the point is it's increasing. And the prediction was that pretty soon everybody will either have autism or be taking care of somebody who does.
And we may, you know, and these are usually done, you know, the studies are usually done with 8-year-olds.
Okay.
Which means that it's usually 9 or 10 years after birth that you actually get these figures. So I don't know what the 1 in 38 was. Do you know what year the children were born for them?
No, I don't. There's also a differential between boys and girls, of course. So, you have to know the age.
Well, that was what I was going to mention, is that in the, for whatever reason, males are more sensitive than females to both ADHD and autism. And so we might even be up to a situation where in 2018, we could be up to a situation where almost every male baby is an autism baby.
Right.
It's possible.
So
we don't know what it is, and we won't know for quite a while.
If this is true, that it's being, you know, caused through the mechanism of disrupting the calcium flow into the cell and making it too much, mm-hmm. what determines when that reaches the point where it's irreversible? I mean, you know, if you took away not just by taking away the influence, but if there was some way to get the cell to start rejecting the excess calcium, what do you know what determines when that's no longer possible?
No, I don't. And let me just say, there are some people who think that autism is treatable and at least partially reversible.
Mm-hmm.
But certainly conventional medicine doesn't accept that.
No.
So based on conventional medicine, we're in stunning difficulty with this whole autism thing. And how can we not do this? I mean, how can we just go ahead blindly with these things?
It's stunning. When you say how can we go ahead, there's two we's involved. There's the we's that are rolling out this program that are saying that there's no problem. And there's the rest of the we's that trust that. That are being told there's nothing we can do. And most people believe there's nothing they can do.
I think, right.
Sorry, I mean, I'm not trying to be negative. It's just when we say we are doing it, it is definitely being done in a very organized, coordinated, intentional fashion, but not by most of the population. It's being done by the industry and its government partners. So when you look at their motivation, when the top levels understand that it's damaging, that at that level, it's not out of ignorance that it's not healthy, because they're going to big lengths to hide that. They're doing it anyway, which is a very strange motivation pattern, because ultimately it will affect them as well.
Yeah, it's bizarre. And all of this stuff was based on this claim that there are only thermal effects.
Right.
And there were thousands of studies that were known all the way back in the 1970s that showed that there were non-thermal effects.
But they've learned that if they just tell all the newscasters on the teleprompters to say there's no such thing, everybody figures, well, it must be true.
Well, yeah, well.
Television can't lie, it would short circuit or something.
I'm sorry?
Television can't lie, it would short circuit or something like that.
Well, I don't know. It's just absolutely bizarre. I mean, it's something. You know, I never ever thought when I got into science that I would see anything even 1% as concerning as what I'm seeing here.
Right.
You know, it is. It's just bizarre beyond belief. And, you know, you can see, you know, the basic problem we have is, you know, and here we're just talking about brain function and we're just talking about reproductive function. And the brain function, of course, can show up in multiple ways.
Mm-hmm.
And we've already said some things about those, but what happens when our collective brain function falls below what we need for the running of our society? And we may be getting close to that.
There's strong evidence that may be part of the problem right now.
You know, but
one of the things you mentioned, of course, the brain controls hormone levels, and you mentioned that was one of the effects of the EMF, and I've noticed there's a new branch of medicine that they consider very advanced, where they're constantly checking your blood and saying, oh, well, your hormone levels are off, but don't worry because we can give you all these hormone balancing injections and pills and things like that, and you'll be great. We just need to do that every week or something. And it could be connected to this increasing influence of the hormones being thrown off by the EMFs, it sounds like, from what you're saying.
Yeah. Well, they are thrown off by the EMFs, and they get thrown off. It's not all in one direction. You can get increases and you can get decreases in hormone activity,
right,
depending on the circumstances. You know, it's not a simple relationship, and so that's something that I think is important to know. By the way, the way in which the steroid hormones are affected is different from the way in which the non-steroid hormones are affected, but they are both affected.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a huge complexity here, and when you think about it from the standpoint of basic biology, you know, what things do we have that are most important to our functioning as human beings that make us different from other creatures and that are most essential for our differences? What do you have? You've got a brain function,
mm-hmm,
which is being severely attacked in multiple ways by the EMFs. You've got the hormone systems, which are important for different parts of the body communicating with each other.
Right.
And then you have the stuff that goes on in the cell, the regulation in our individual cells, and calcium regulation is probably the most important regulatory system. There are several others that are important. So that's very important. And then what else are you doing? We're also attacking the DNA of our cells, the thing which makes us different from every other species on Earth, and we're attacking that, and I think we're probably severely attacking that. So when you look at this from the standpoint of the biology, it's hard to see how anything could be worse other than just instantaneous death.
Right. Well, you know, and it occurs to me, too, that we mentioned that they're saying, well, that's just because the public is demanding it, so we're just trying to serve the public. One of the things that they're also doing it for is this huge program, actually under UN Agenda 21, but it's called the Internet of Things. Do you know much about that? They want to put a communicating chip inside every item on the entire planet.
Yeah, and that, of course, has its own problems with the question of privacy, among other things.
Yeah, I could imagine that.
But, we've gone so far beyond Big Brother is watching you. From 1984 that it's almost impossible to imagine.
1984 is 34 years in the past now. It's pretty strange, but
it's old. Anyway,
the other thing is,
maybe your readers may not know that 1984 was an important novel that was published.
Yeah, that's still a really big deal. Everybody should read or watch that. But the other thing is, you mentioned they're going to put in all of these 5G transmitters, like, I don't know what it is, every 300 feet or something, just so that, you know, they tell you that, oh, wait, now you'll be able to dial 911 no matter where you are. It's going to be great. But just in case there are any rural areas that don't have 5G transmitters every 300 feet, they're looking at some kind of low-altitude satellite blimps or balloons or something so that they can fill in the gaps from above. Have you heard about that?
I hadn't heard about that, but, you know, that's,
you've got to have equal access to advanced technology, you know. Otherwise,
anyway, I don't know. The whole thing is not so. Yeah, it's crazy.
Science fiction.
Well, I can't believe this stuff. I mean, how could you believe this stuff?
Nobody would have if it were predicted, you know, 50 years ago or something like that.
No. Anyway, it's impossible to get your head around. I mean, I have to say, if I hadn't been researching this stuff for the last 6 years or so, I probably wouldn't believe it either.
Right? No, it's not very believable.
Yeah.
And I think that the industry is hoping it won't be believable as something to really be concerned about. You know, of course, why would you ever think that these advanced government agencies would let anything unsafe ever happen?
And they think the government has tested these and they wouldn't let them out, but the government
of course
tested any of, huh?
Of course, and the same with all the drugs and vaccines and everything, but found out that their testing is asking the industry if it's okay or not.
Anyway.
So, I mean, our two subjects that we were looking at is what it is, you know, how it works, and whether it's good or bad for people's health. And it seems like that's pretty clear from what you've been saying, and it's been known for a long time.
Yeah, it's been known for a long time. Let me just say, and I want to raise this because it is important, and it is it's genuine. Mm-hmm. There are real therapeutic effects of these EMFs, and they also work via VGCC activation, but at different levels.
I've heard of bone healing from pulsed electromagnetic frequencies.
That's the one that's been most studied, and that's the one that I discussed actually in my 2013 paper.
Okay.
And so there are genuine therapeutic effects when you have EMFs that are at the right level, that are focused on the right part of the body that needs some help. Okay. You can get therapeutic effects. And it's important to realize that. Now, what One of the things, you know, there's so many things that I keep saying they're bizarre beyond belief. Mm-hmm. One of the things that's also bizarre beyond belief is the industry denies all these. Why do they do that? Well, basically because they're trying to maintain this fiction that they're only thermal effects, and mm-hmm. and because the therapeutic effects are also non-thermal, they don't want to admit that they exist.
And, oh, that's interesting.
So it's we're in a crazy world. We really are. It's just mm-hmm. It's just insane. And now I think before one of the things that that I'm most concerned about in this whole pattern is that many of the effects that we see appear to be cumulative, and they at least eventually become irreversible
mm-hmm.
in their properties, at least based on conventional medicine.
Yeah.
And so that that seems to be true for the reproductive effects shown by the mouse study that I discussed earlier,
right.
Where, you know, once it gets past a certain point, it doesn't reverse, at least just by taking the fields away.
Mm-hmm.
I think that there's a lot of evidence that this is true of the effects on the brain, and that they tend to be cumulative, and they eventually become irreversible. The mutational DNA effects, so the effects of the attacks on the DNA producing mutations, are inherently cumulative and inherently irreversible. So because you keep generating more and more mutations, you don't reverse the ones that are already there, except with extraordinarily rarely. These are all things, and there are other effects that are probably cumulative and irreversible, including the cardiac effects, and including the production of, autism based on conventional medicine, and ADHD based on conventional medicine, and the effects on the neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's.
Right.
And by the way, something I haven't mentioned is that there is a type of dementia which has been called digital dementia. People who are using digital devices, such as the internet, for example.
Wow.
Extensively develop dementia-like, and these can be very young people.
Is this wireless exclusively or not?
I think it probably is, but I don't know that anybody's run that, you know, done the study on it, you know.
Yeah.
You know, because basically you can, of course, access the internet in a wired fashion and still use it just as well. But when people discuss these things, they discuss them in terms of things like screen time.
Yeah, which is a whole other issue.
And they ignore the issue of the physiological effects of the EMFs. And so that's another issue, and it's something that, you know, I've talked to some people about who are in this field, but I don't know that, you know, the serious question, we know that the EMFs have, you know, major physiological effects on the brain. So, you know, that these need to be considered, and the brain, according to a lot of the old studies that were done back in the Soviet Union back in the 1950s and 1960s, is the most sensitive organ in the entire body in animals to the EMFs, it's certainly not the only organ that's sensitive, but it's the most sensitive. So, you know, so we're, in fact, the whole nervous system is highly sensitive to the EMFs. So, you know, it's, Yeah, it's and by the way, part of the reason that the neurons are so sensitive is because the VGCCs, the voltage-gated calcium channels, have essential roles in the release of every single neurotransmitter in the brain. And by the way, they also have essential roles in the release of most of the hormones in the body.
Wow.
So the hormone effects are not surprising. As I mentioned before, they're very important in the electrical control of the heart. So it's not surprising that you have these cardiac effects.
It's amazing something so important is so unknown. I don't think most people have ever heard of a calcium channel before.
Well, probably not. Yeah, and they. Yeah, it's bizarre. It is totally bizarre. And so, it's basically, the system is really not that hard to understand if you understand, basic biology and a little bit of basic physics. It's not hard to understand it.
So up to now, people have been advised by the ones aware of wireless problems too. Have everything hardwired in your house, hardwire your computer. Don't put your cell phone against your body ever, which I think is a really good idea. Put it on a table and use speakerphone if you have to use it. And don't buy devices that can't be wired. But the situation changes when they put up a 5G transmitter outside your window.
Yeah. And it also changes. And it's already changed for... the 30% of the population.
Well, yeah, you said we're all near...
There are other cell phone towers, they're all being impacted.
Right, and many of us are near cell phone towers now that you can't even tell they're there. They're disguised.
Well, yeah. And let me just say one other thing about this. We've talked about animals, we've talked about humans, but... all animals, it's not just mammals, but insects and every single animal in the whole animal kingdom is impacted much the same way that we are. What's interesting is that plants are also affected in very similar ways. In plants, they also the EMFs also activate channels, calcium channels. They're not the same as the ones in our bodies, but they get activated by in the plants. And so most of the effects in plants are also mediated through excessive calcium in the cells. And it turns out that the impact on plants is very important. And I think one of the concerns is that the EMFs make plants more flammable. And I think this may be very important in causing some of the fires that we've seen in the last
year. I thought of that too.
So more and more you look at these things from different standpoints and you see all kinds of things where you can make at least a reasonable case or all kinds of different effects. And, it gets crazier and crazier.
Yeah, when you weigh the convenience of being able to download multiple movies at the same time against destroying the entire biosphere, it shouldn't be that hard to decide what makes sense.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It shouldn't be hard at all. It should not be hard at all. And let me just say something about that, in terms of 5G. So the industry, as I said, claims that, this is going to affect mainly the outer 1 or 2 millimeters of our bodies. But even if that were true, and I think clearly it's not true, those effects will be much stronger in smaller organisms. And And so insects and small mammals and birds will be much more affected than
honeybees.
Honeybees are strongly affected by the EMFs, and there's a substantial literature on that. I think that plants, including large trees, are going to be heavily affected, because even in large trees, the leaves and the reproductive organs are highly exposed. So when you have that going on,
makes you wonder if they're going to stop reproducing too, right?
Oh yeah, I think we're going to have conflagrations all over the place because of the flammability thing. That's what I think. We could just burn up.
But to quote Mr. Wheeler, the last FCC president, it's going to generate a tremendous amount of wonderful economic activity, and he said that's damn important.
Well,
direct quote.
Yeah, right. I know. Yeah, right. Anyway, yeah. Okay.
So as a bottom line, since people can't just solve this by plugging their computer into a hardwired Ethernet cable, do you think that they should try to present some of this stuff to their local rulers and authorities and local governments and state governments and things like that?
I think we have to do that. We're just in effect collaborating with our self destruction and the destruction of everything we care about.
Yeah,
everything we care about is already being attacked by the EMF. So we need not only to stop 5G and probably 4G as well, but we need to start reversing a lot of this stuff.
Yeah,
because when you have these effects that are cumulative and become irreversible, we have very limited time.
What's really amazing is I recently found out from multiple sources that almost the entire needed infrastructure for doing it all with fiber optic cables is already installed.
Yeah, and it works much better, and it works faster, and it's much more secure.
Exactly. Yeah, in fact, it can be upgraded indefinitely with speed just by changing the hardware at the two ends.
Yeah. Okay, I didn't know that, but I'm not surprised. Yeah.
Yeah. Good feature.
Yeah. It's crazy. Everything's crazy. I was going to talk about two of the things that I don't think I've talked. Oh yeah, okay. So I talked about the DNA effects and the concern that the chromosomal rearrangements may lead to much more severe reproductive effects in the next generation than the already substantial effects that we're seeing now. Because of the chromosomal rearrangements, there's a similar concern, or at least somewhat similar concern, with regard to these prenatal and early postnatal neurological effects, because we already have, and you and I both mentioned the fact that the autism and ADHD are much more common in males than in females.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been argued by a number of people, and I take no credit for this, that whatever's going on in autism is producing, many other neurological problems, and that because autism is much more common in males than in females, that these other neurological problems are also selectively impacting males.
Yeah.
And we already have a high level of male dysfunction in our society, and in fact in other societies around the world. And that has huge, huge impacts already. Now, if these are caused by, you know, the prenatal and postnatal exposures, and you're talking about males who were, you know, 15, 20, 30 years old having big impacts, what about the young ones that are coming up? They have vastly more exposures.
Yeah, exactly. And that's aside from the issue that they're going to be increasing the exposure after they get born.
Yeah. Right, exactly. Yeah. And so that's true. You know, we've got another huge time bomb coming down. And you put these things together, I mean, you know, it's just incredible, you know, and what you know, that doesn't include, you know, the autism and other dementias. It doesn't include, you know, there are just so many different things
right. That
are very, 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 very concerning. And, you know, we can't ignore these things.
What would you want to leave people with? I mean, I'd like to see not necessarily unrealistic positive hope, but where do you think people's attention should be at this point to try to make some contribution to this situation?
Well, I think that what needs to be done is to have we need a giant revolt on the political system. We need a giant revolt on the political system, you know, to say this has got to stop.
Right, and your problem is people on both sides running against each other, and both of them are working for the industries or making promises and then ignoring them.
You know, I don't know how you do it. You have to keep pounding on them, and you know, and if
maybe some good people need to run for office too.
Well, I think it has to come from below in this case.
Yeah.
You know, the fact is that, you know, at this point in time, the politicians are more concerned about the money. You know, I mean, the telecom industry is a tremendously wealthy and powerful industry.
Right.
And they're more concerned about that than they are about a public uprising. And the only way to turn that around is to have a public uprising that shows that doesn't work anymore.
Yeah.
That's the only way to do it. Now, is there any possibility of that happening? I don't know. You know, it may be that our goose is cooked and that's it, and we're going down. And it may be that that's where we are. I don't know. But I don't see, what else can we do? And
yeah,
every single thing that we care about, I don't care, every one of your listeners, I don't care what they care about,
mm-hmm.
every single thing is being attacked.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, and they need to know that, and they need to, you know, and let me just say, I want to make this clear. It is easier for me to make these cases than it is for most other people to make the case, because I'm a scientist and I've got credentials and I've got publications and I've got, you know, a knowledge of the science.
Mm-hmm.
But. You know, and I know that, and I know that when I talk to lay people, many of them are very interested in this. And yeah, there's still a few skeptics around, but they're relatively few. You know, they really, you know, when you come down to it, people are very interested in this, and I've seen this over and over and over again. It's partly because, yeah, I've got the arguments, I've got the credentials, and I can make them, but I can't do this, and even, you know, a few scientists can't do it. I mean, we've got in the EU right now, I mean, they're almost as bad off as we are in the U.S., mm-hmm. Where the European Commission is trying to push 5G on them.
Right.
I don't think they made the final decisions, but there are some countries that are already putting this stuff out. And in the EU, and there was a petition by 240 over 240 scientists from various countries to the EU, to the European Commission about this. And at this point, there's been, you know, nothing useful that's come from that, except that they haven't gone ahead with it yet at the commission level.
Right.
So maybe there's hope. I don't know. But at this point, it's not clear that there's hope there either. So anyway, I don't know.
Maybe one of the messages would be for people to stop fighting over secondary issues and realize this is a common interest, and they might as well cooperate.
This is something. I think many of us are crisis fatigued. And I understand that. I understand that fully. All I can say is this alone will destroy us, in my judgment.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, and completely apart from any of the other crises, this will destroy us. And it will do it rather quickly, I would think. And so, you know, when you're in that situation, you have to act on it. And that's something useful. Let me raise one other thing that's kind of interesting here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've been asked, are there any international political leaders that have an understanding of this? And at this point, I can only think of one international political leader who has who's in a high position, who seems to have at least some understanding of it.
Me too.
And that person is, interestingly, Vladimir Putin.
Yeah, exactly. And there's a reason that he's totally demonized by the media right now.
Well, I'm not going to get into that. All I'm saying is, okay, so this is interesting. I don't, you know,
Isn't he trying to keep Wi-Fi out of the schools over there and hardwire the computers and do things like that?
I don't know about those specifics, but what I do know is that, Russia has at least pro forma safety guidelines that are 1,000 times more stringent than ours.
Right.
But what's interesting is that there was a... So, you know, I was interviewed by Dr. Mercola and Dr. Dietrich Klinghart was also interviewed by him, both having to do with the MF stuff.
Yeah.
And in the Mercola interview, Dr. Klinghart has a statement in there which apparently he got from one of his colleagues who's from Russia, that Putin made a statement, and I'm not going to give it to you word for word because I don't remember it word for word, but basically that he was asked, is Russia going to get in a war with the U.S.? And his response was that Russia doesn't need to get in a war with the U.S. because the U.S. is, because of the way the U.S. uses electrical things. He didn't talk about EMS, but electrical things.
Yeah.
And that because of the way we're using electrical things, that we're all going to end up in a mental hospital. And that's not at all unreasonable given the neuropsychiatric effects of the EMFs. And that, Russia will take over then. And that's... Yeah.
Well, there's a pretty good argument that the American society is a lot like a mental hospital now.
Well, so that's not implausible. Well, so then the question I ask myself is, well, does Putin really understand this? You know, is he really, is this something that's substantive? And in thinking about it, I think it probably is substantive, because Putin was head of the KGB during the last years of the Soviet Union.
Mm-hmm.
When the Soviet Union was doing the largest numbers of occupational exposure studies to EMFs that have ever been done.
Right.
And so he probably knows about these things. And if you look at the most prominent symptoms that you see in these people who were exposed to the EMFs, they are the neuropsychiatric symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what comes out of those Soviet... Now, there are other things that are going on there, too, but those are the most obvious things. And so I think Putin probably knows that, and he probably knows that he knows about those studies, and that's where his understanding comes from.
But beyond that, it appears that he actually doesn't want to destroy his own people. Because he could know about that, like the heads of the industry, and still go ahead with it. He's not doing that, and he's pushing organic food. You know, he's giving land to people, supporting families, and all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. Well, I don't know much about what's going on in Russia, and I don't know much about the things you're just discussing, but. What I did find, and I put it in that document that I sent you, is that Putin rarely uses a smartphone.
Yeah,
he avoids the use of any. So apparently in his own life, he's using this information.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that he does have a real understanding, and if you look at what he stated, it suggests that he has an understanding that these effects are cumulative and that they often become irreversible.
Right.
And those are both obviously very important factors here. So that's...
I don't think he necessarily wants to use it against the U.S. He made all kinds of overtures to become allies and has been brushed off so far. But the fact that he understands it means that it is possible for a high-level leader to also be one that is aware of these things and has good motives. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, he doesn't have to deal with the telecom industry in Russia,
No, I'm sure he's had opportunities, though.
Well, maybe.
It's not like they don't want Russia. So
I don't know, but right. The world gets crazier and crazier as time goes on.
Okay.
So
well, it's a great class. Is there any last thing that you would want to leave people remembering, or because I think we covered a lot of ground here that's really useful.
Yeah. Well, I think there are a lot of ways in which we can protect ourselves. Each of them takes some effort, but protect ourselves, protect our families. There are ways of using shielding I don't have a cell phone, but I do use one on rare occasions when there's an emergency. I have everything hardwired in my house except for my garage door opener.
You're caught.
I'm connected to the internet, which I have to use every day, but it's through wired connections. I've got a wired keyboard, I've got a wired mouse, I've got my printer is wired, everything that I can possibly wire is wired, and there are lots of things that you can do to improve things. And the telephone I'm speaking on is an old fashioned wired telephone. So
yeah, not a wireless handset.
Yeah. So so there are lots of things you can do, and they are less convenient, but the alternatives are completely unacceptable.
Yeah.
But the crucial thing we've got to stop 5G and probably have to stop 4G in the process, and then start reversing some of these things. Otherwise, we're going down the tubes, and we're doing it rather quickly.
So it might even be important enough to stop fighting about other stuff and cooperate.
Yeah, and we've got to get Wi-Fi out of the schools, which was incredibly stupid. There's no reason why you can't connect to the internet in a wired fashion in the schools if you really want to connect to the internet.
Yeah.
And, so there's so many things. We need to get the cell phone towers so they're much less, they're giving us much less exposure, and it's not that hard to do. And by the way, one thing I didn't mention in that study that I talked about the pregnant cattle in Switzerland.
Mm-hmm.
Switzerland has safety guidelines that are 100 times more stringent than ours. So they only allow 1/100th of the amount of radiation from these cell phone towers.
So you said it's not that hard. How do you make less exposure from a cell phone tower?
Well, first of all, you put them up in the sky a long way.
Okay.
The worst things that we have are these cell phone towers that are down near the levels that people are at. And I think, you could probably even do this with broadcasting antennas. You could probably just bounce them off things so that they're going up instead of down.
Mm-hmm.
Interestingly, some of these cell phone towers are actually designed pretty decently. For example, there's a park not too far from where I live, which is it's called Tabor Park, and it's got it is a little old volcano sitting there, hopefully an extinct one, and on the top of it there is a cell phone tower. And so one time when I was going up there, I took my meter with me, and I was wondering how much exposure I'm getting from that cell phone tower.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing was that I was getting very little exposure from the cell phone tower, and basically because it's designed to broadcast out towards the horizon, not down towards the ground.
Okay.
And a lot of them are, but then there are a lot of them that are too low. So when they're going out horizontally, you're getting a lot of radiation from them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a big problem. And so, there are better ways to do these things than what we're doing. I don't know, and I'm sure you could probably redesign your cell phone so they were more sensitive too. It would cost a little bit, but and the problem with the cell phones is that these smartphones are much more dangerous because they pulse a lot more, or at least potentially more dangerous.
Right.
So they're problematic, and people have to know about these things. And let me just say, when you measure just the what they call SAR values, the amount of heating that's produced by these things, that really doesn't tell you very much that's important.
Right.
Of all these pulsations, and the pulsations are very important. So there are lots of things going on here that mean that the way in which we talk about these things is by and large not very useful. So there are a lot of ways you can improve things. You can buy little pouches that have shielding on one side.
Right.
So if you carry your cell phone with the shielded side towards your body, you're getting much less radiation. You can do that, and it can still pick up signals from outside. So, you know, there are a lot of ways in which you can do this. You can buy shields to put on the bottom of your laptop. That may be somewhat useful. You can put shielding on your car windows so you're not getting so much radiation when you're driving around town. Of course, then you can't use your cell phone in the car. But
is there a danger from the EMF when your computer is hardwired?
No, there's probably some, but it's much less.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, you do get stuff coming from the screen, but yeah, it's much less. It's much less. So, you know, there are lots and lots of ways that these things can be improved. But, you know, right now, what are people doing? They're just taking whatever the companies put out and figure, well, it's, you know, I don't have much choice.
Yeah.
But if you had a demand, you know, I want things, you know, and I'm not going to buy your stuff if you don't give them to me, then the companies would respond. Now,
yeah,
you know,
true.
So, you know, they're not stupid.
Right, right. Anyway. Other than global suicide, they're not stupid. I agree.
Well, they're not. Yeah, I mean, you know,
right. There's just that one detail they're still working
on. When it affects their bottom line in the short term, they will respond.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Okay, well, we'll look forward to another episode with you, and thanks for the great class. And if you hold on, we'll say goodbye and do the final stuff in the break here.
Okay, great.
Okay, guys, that was Dr. Martin Pall, Professor Emeritus of Biochemistry and Basic Medical Sciences at Washington State University. Hope you enjoyed that incredible discussion and all the information he presented. It might be worth listening to more than once, and fortunately you'll have that recording available to you with all the other archives that we've got at blogtalkradio.com/lostartsradio or through our site at lostartsradio.com. And obviously this 5G and microwave radiation topic is incredibly important. Essentially, it's one of the many assaults on humanity and on all life forms on our planet that are going on right now and that are ramping up and that are intended to get a lot more intense, along with chemical agriculture, drug medicine, petroleum for energy, nuclear power, geoengineering, and a lot more. These are all coordinated. They're not individual issues just coming from totally separated sources. All the toxic technologies like this are being promoted also by fake education, fake science, programmed entertainment, and a central banking system that's issuing fake money to the biggest destroyers of life in collusion with corrupt governments worldwide. So we got kind of a serious situation going on here. This is not to be upset about or to feel despondent or despairing or out of control, angry, or anything like that. You need to be focused and centered inside yourself in order to access the energy that's going to be required to turn this around. So one of the things, though, on the surface is it's really essential, I think, that we counter all the fake information, misleading information, malicious information with real information before it all gets outlawed as hate speech, which is in the works right now, you guys. And the new version of hate speech that they're going to come out with, pretending to work to protect us, is called hate facts. How brilliant are these guys? They are super creative. And the reason they needed a new term like hate facts is that what about the people? What are they going to do about the people, you know, those of us that are bringing out things that are true, but which they can't afford for anybody to hear? Well, so that they don't have to prove them untrue, which they can't do, they say, all right, they're facts, but they're hate facts. In other words, it's just going to be totally terrible for everybody and harmful and hurtful and all the other things, politically incorrect, if you say these things. So therefore, we're going to define them as hate facts, and you'll have to go to prison if you talk about them. I'm not saying that I want this to happen, but they're planning this right now. So real information on all these issues, the ones I mentioned and all the others, needs to get out quickly to everybody, widespread. Everybody needs to stop fighting about irrelevant details, worrying about what label you are, if you're a liberal or conservative or Democrat or Republican or, you know, supposedly white or black or various other races. Or, this is all total distraction to keep you upset, divided, confused, and working against each other, so that the people that are really doing this, the destructive activities, can keep on doing them and they won't even be noticed. So we have to be smart enough to see through all that, stop the stupid fighting, and cooperate with each other for our common interests, which are individual freedom, toxin-free planet, which is very possible. We haven't needed petroleum energy, for example, for 100 years or more. All the real stuff is available. The real information on health, which is being violently suppressed, has been available since the beginning. So what's the biggest fear of the power structure? That you'll find out about geoengineering or about GMOs or about chemical agriculture or nuclear? No, those aren't the biggest fears. Those are fears. They're full of fears of all kinds. But the biggest fear is that you, who are supposed to think that you're helpless, weak, limited, and temporary being of dust, you know, that amounts to nothing, their biggest fear is that you ever find out that's the opposite of the truth, and that you have vast, virtually unlimited healing power flowing through you that you can direct once you learn how to be self-aware. You can direct that, and their whole game will be over. If you wake up, I mean, not be able to recite the problems in the world like the ones I just mentioned. I mean, really wake up. Experience yourself as who you actually are. Learn about consciousness. You know why we're so inundated with the academic focus? It's not because it's completely wrong, but because it's of very minor importance compared to consciousness. And the way we're educated and trained, we're supposed to not even know what that word means. But it's connected to who we are. That's the main thing that we have to find out. The old saying that you may have heard of, first know thyself, and then you can know everything else, basically. That was true. It's still true. It's still available to you. Even now, with the things in such bad shape as they are, and the malevolent agendas so far progressed down the road as they are today, life on Earth would heal if you and a few others wake up. Doesn't take a majority, doesn't take millions. That's a myth. It's so powerful that it wouldn't take too many people. So the situation we're in right now, the struggle to wake up and heal everything and bring back harmony and as close to heaven on earth as we can while we're here, that's not going to be won by conventional force. And that's why they want you to be incited into going crazy and rioting in the cities, destroying your own stuff. I mean, this is really dumb, you guys. This is really dumb. I'm talking to all the racist groups, white, black, brown, yellow, red, any kind of racism is really stupid. And it's falling for what they want. Any kind of division of labeling yourself on one side so you hate everybody on the other side, this is equally stupid. Find out who you really are and realize that everybody else is the same thing as you. Even the so-called worst of the bad guys, they're the same too. This is a secret they can't even afford for their own people to learn, because it's the smokescreen behind which is the real healing force that we need to access. Their force is much stronger than the conventional ones, and they're available to you right now. The real healing forces, they want hidden forever, but that's not going to happen. So if you have any interest in that, and I mean not just academic interest, if you're willing to do some serious work inside yourself, not just out marching or protesting or signing petitions, although those things might be needed, that's not the real work. The real work is what you do behind the scenes while you're doing that and when you're not doing that and all the time. And it's demanding, but it's not stressful. It's very demanding, but it takes all your attention and it teaches you to relax and get in touch with something you've forgotten for longer than you would even believe. So if you have any interest in that, I'm speaking to the people out there, not the general public, but the ones who sense that there's something that they're missing that they could really access, and they're ready to stop fighting everybody and learn how to activate the force that could heal the situation, then check out what we're doing now on Saturday. Every Saturday night, you're invited. We've been waiting for you. You can find out a few more details and how to get access at lostarts radio.com/club. It's not an exclusive club at all. You're invited. I'm in it. Everybody is in it who wants to do the work. It's only exclusive to those that are willing to drop things that they thought were real that may not be. There may be more to things than they realized. If you're willing to do that work in yourself, we're waiting for you. lostartsradio.com/club. Check it out. The secret is inside you, like the red slippers that Dorothy was always wearing in the Wizard of Oz. That's like what's really going on. And we'll talk about that if you want to join us. In the meantime, look for more incredible guests joining us on the Sunday open shows. And I hope everything goes great for you this week and ever after. And we'll see you next time.
As of January 2018, the Saturday Live Call-In Show is now an interactive video platform called the Planetary Healing Club. The cost is just a $10 minimum monthly donation, automatically billed through your PayPal account. Sign up at lostartsradio.com/club. The Planetary Healing Club is every Saturday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. You get your link to participate in the show upon signing up as a member. Those shows are also archived as well for club members. Listen to our new shows with guests every Sunday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. All Sunday shows with guests have archives freely available on our website at lostartsradio.com. You can also find them at blogtalkradio.com/lostartsradio, as well as our YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/LostArtsRadio. Mixcloud at mixcloud.com/LostArtsRadio. And finally, look us up under the podcast directory on iTunes. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/LostArtsRadio or on Twitter at LostArtsRadio. Be sure to join the free Lost Arts Radio Facebook group as well. Just search for Lost Arts Radio Group within Facebook. You can also join our forum on our website if you want to interact with other listeners. We also have links to all of the great independent musicians whose music we feature each week on Lost Arts Radio. When you do your Amazon shopping, please use Amazon Smile program at smile.amazon.com. And when you choose Lost Arts Research Institute in Sedona, Arizona as your charity, Amazon will donate 0.5% of whatever your order total is to Lost Arts Research Institute to help fund the building of the school and keep our radio show on the air. Please visit lostartsresearchinstitute.org for more information on the school we want to build. Be sure to sign up for our free weekly newsletter on our site under the radio show tab or right from the button on our Facebook page. Contact Richard at richard@lostartsradio.com or myself, Doug Diamond, at doug@lostartsradio.com. Thanks again for listening to Lost Arts Radio, and we'll see you again next week.
The most wonderful things seem just out of your reach. Faces and places seem strange and they steady your feet. You lay your head down, thinking nobody cares. You look around, thinking nobody's there. You weather the storm, it's all right, rely.